Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to today's International Women's Day webinar at Dr. Vithal Rao Vikhe Patil Foundation's Medical College and Hospital. Today, Dr. Mrs. Urmila Gavadi ma'am will give a brief lecture on women's health. Dr. Mrs. Ausert ma'am will tell us about women empowerment, and Dr. Mrs. Raut ma'am will let us know what are the details of our institute's women complaints committee. I request Dr. Respected Dean Dr. Sunil Nata Maske sir to give his ideas about International Women's Day. Sir, wait, I'll unmute you, sir. Sir, you need to unmute yourself, sir, first. Sir,
sir, now.
Yes, sir.
शुरू करना है क्या?
हाँ, यस सर.
ओके. ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ डॉक्टर विठ्ठलराव विखे पाटील फाउंडेशन मेडिकल कॉलेज एंड हॉस्पिटल अहमदनगर, आई डॉक्टर सुनील मस्के, डीन मेडिकल कॉलेज एंड हॉस्पिटल, विशेष ऑल द बेस्ट ऑन द ओकेजन ऑफ वुमेन्स डे. नाउ ऑन दिस थीम ओनली, विद द हेल्प ऑफ सोशल सेल एंड वुमेन्स कंप्लेंट्स कमिटी, we have planned this lecture of the related with the women's. I wish all the best for this organizers and for all the participants as well as those who are today's speakers. Thank you sir.
Now I request Dr. Urmila Gavadi ma'am to please say a few words regarding women's health. Yes ma'am, over to you ma'am.
Good afternoon, everyone. I would first like to thank all the dignitaries and social cells for giving me an opportunity to talk about the women's health on this occasion. Now, to talk about the women's health in 10 minutes is quite a challenge because women goes through various phases of pregnancy, lactation, menstruation, and a menopause, which poses her to difficult health conditions and challenges. But I will still like to touch few of the areas that needs to be addressed even now. First, I like to talk about is nutrition. And yes, it still needs to be talked, and that is a very sad state of our country. When we talk about the nutrition, we always learn that the woman's nutritional requirements are always less than a man, less calorie requirement, less protein requirement. But we never understood that, as I already told you, that woman's physical changes throughout her life actually poses her to many of the risks such as osteoporosis and anemia. So your nutrition should be actually much better than a man. It is different. It is not less. So it should be good in iron, calcium, vitamin D, vitamin C. And when I'm talking about nutrition, it is not the quantity. It is the quality of the food is important. So yes, as a woman, cultivating good habits at early age is very important. Nowadays, what am I seeing is many of the girls, young girls, are so addicted to the junk food that they are coming to us with irregular menses, thyroid problems. And when we tell them that the part of it is because of their nutritional habits, for them it is very difficult to believe. We are looking at the countries of like USA and UK, and we are trying to inculcate their habits, but we are not understanding that the countries are still, and actually they have a epidemic of obesity in their country, and which we shouldn't want in our country. Not only you should be eating in a right quantity, but you should be eating local produce and seasonal fruits, and not anything fancy that is not required. Another thing in nutritional I would like to talk about is requirement of calcium and vitamin D. Now, as I already told you, generally women take that during lactation and pregnancy because we prescribe it to them but not afterwards, but we don't understand that women are more likely to suffer from osteoporosis than men. And to enter the our postmenopausal state with weak bones is definitely will pose a difficult health problem for them, because they will be taking care of their grandchildren when their daughter-in-law will be going to jobs. So I will highly recommend women to take care of their bone health during the right age, I will say. So start early, start exercising, take a good diet, nutritious diet with local produce, nothing fancy, nothing costly is required, but this will play a big role for you as far as your health over a long term and throughout your life is concerned. Next, I want to talk about something which is very less talked about, is menstrual hygiene. And yes, it breaks my heart when a young girl comes to me with local infections and she's not aware of the basic menstrual hygiene. On a contrary, menstrual hygiene has a long-term consequences on the reproductive health of a woman. And it can pose her to many of the fungal infections, bacterial infections, even something as bad as toxic shock syndrome and death. So menstrual hygiene is very important. Many surveys have been done which found that the incidence and prevalence of self-reported dysmenorrhea and menorrhagia is much less in our country compared to the developed countries. And is that the reason? The reason behind is not because our girls have better menstrual health, but the reason for that is our girls do not have access, or even if they have an access, they do not prefer to go to the doctor with this complaint, because menstruation is something that is not talked about in our society. So knowing the menstrual hygiene is very important. They should know that not only wearing a sanitary pad is not menstrual hygiene, because we are under impression that you are not using a cloth, that means you are, you know, menstrual hygiene. That is not correct. Changing the pad frequently, every 4 to 6 hourly, and even more frequently if it is fully soaked, is also important. I have seen medical students not changing their pads for almost 24 hours. So that, and even the local hygiene, people are using Dettols and soaps and whatnot. No, you can either buy store-bought intimate washes for that, or even lukewarm water is more than enough. But we need to take care of it to prevent infections, prevent infertility. So it is very, very important as far as the hygiene is concerned. Next, I want to just touch a particular area, which is again never talked about, but I see such patients, and again, it breaks my heart because it has a long-term consequences. It's sexually transmitted diseases.
College activity for play, after family process.
Sorry for that. Now, why I want to talk about the sexually transmitted diseases is that in our country, the girl or a boy after a particular age are never sensitized to this. And I see, yes, I do see medical students and girls from engineering colleges and outside also coming with sexually transmitted diseases to my clinics, thinking that it is just a local infection. So if you cannot talk to your children about it, you can or very well take them to a gynecologist. But I personally feel, instead of avoiding the talk, if you sensitize them, if you tell them the consequences of such practices, then I think they are less likely to be indulged into such activities. And I think you'll be more safe, that your daughter is living a safer lifestyle. And that is something I always want to talk about. And next, I am skipping the pregnancy part, because I think when a woman is pregnant, everybody's taking care of her. She is also taking care of herself. So those are generally not an affected area. But other, when a woman is not pregnant, nobody's taking care of her health. So another thing I want to talk about is cancer screening. Now, we have breast cancer and cervical cancer as one of the leading causes of death in India even today. And these are the cancers which have stated guidelines about their screening, but still the screening does not happen in reality. No woman that I know, even from medical fraternities, or we are not even telling our relatives to undergo any pap smear, which should be done. With increasing HPV, the cervical cancer is actually occurring at an earlier age. So I will recommend all the women to have cervical cancer screening, that is pap smear, done every 3 yearly. And also self-breast examination. This is something so simple and cheap. It doesn't cost anything. It is a self-breast examination. that nobody is doing that. And then breast cancer is still one of the leading cause of death in our country. So this examination of cervical cancer and breast examination should be done. People should be aware about it. And definitely we can decrease the incidence, or we can early detection of the cancer can be done with this. So this is something I wanted to touch about. And this can be done if woman is giving time for herself. That is very important. I see many of the men undergoing regular health checkups, but I never see a woman. And I'm yet to see a patient coming to me or a lady coming to me saying that I have just come for an annual checkup, that I want to see if everything is fine with me. We have this trend for men, but we do not have this for females. So annual health checkup after the age of 45 is also mandatory for all the females, yes. And what you should do, you should get your blood pressure checked, you should get your thyroid checked, you should get your breast examined by a surgeon. Although you are regularly doing self-examination, it should be get checked by the surgeon. And if required, mammography should be done. General pelvic examination should be done. Cholesterol, women are also prone for the risk. So yes, annual health checkup is important. A simple ultrasonography will diagnose the ovarian tumors. Ovarian tumor is one of, again, a leading cause for which there are no screening guidelines. I'm sorry to say there is no screening guideline. And I operate people who are having the tumors that are size of a 36, filling the whole abdomen. I recently operated a patient. I was very happy as a surgeon, but it breaks my heart how negligent a person has to be. Or should I say, how ignorant a person has to be to keep her health as secondary, to report this late to the hospital. She is moving around with a abdomen that is looking like a full-term pregnancy, but she reported this late. It's only because women keep their health as secondary to every other thing, which should not be done. So you should get an annual checkup. You should follow the guidelines of the doctor, take the health supplementation, and routinely work out. And last thing I want to talk about the health checkup. Time is very less, so I will not go into details of everything. Last is mental health of a woman. Now, today is a Women's Day, and when it comes to Women's Day, any speech starts with the Sanskrit mantra or how a woman is just as God Durga or God Lakshmi and how she is doing everything with a smile on your face. I do not agree with this. I absolutely do not agree with this. Why? We are celebrating every role of a woman today. Role of a daughter, role of a sister, role of a wife and daughter-in-law and mother. And we are like appreciating her today, which is not bad, which is not wrong. I'm not saying it is wrong. But are we not telling her that it is her duty to do all these jobs? Is it not? Are we trying to tell, we are trying to tell her it is duty to do all these jobs with a smile on her face. And if she is anything less than that, she is not Durga. She, on this day of womanhood, why can't we just accept that a woman is just a human being and no goddess? Why can't we accept that? That she is just a human being and not a goddess. So when she does something and she complains about it, listen to that. Every woman at some point in her life has faced molestation. In any form, not physical always. While walking on the street, a small comment can hurt a girl. While traveling, a small touch she will remember for the rest of her life. She gets married, a happy event for everyone. She is suddenly surrounded by so many people she has never met in her life. And with burden of responsibilities. Can a man survive these many traumatic events throughout his life? If a boss says something, he comes and shows it all, throws all his anger and temper tantrums on his wife. Can a man survive all this? No. So, but we say, nah, women are naturally mentally stronger. No, they are not naturally mentally stronger. They are made like that because they are made to believe that they are supposed to be like that. So on this Women's Day, I request, do not look at her as anything special. Look at her as something she's just like we with all the faults of a human being can have. She has all the basic faults that a human being can have. So when she complains, do not label it as a hysteria. Do not label it as a tamasha. Do not label it as dusra chibai ko titar kadhi complain nahi karat. If she is down on some day, she is allowed to be down on that day. And if she wants help for her mental health, she deserves that help. And one should not be ashamed of it. And neither that woman should be ashamed that I'm anything less than a woman. Please, doing all the chores with a smile on your face does not make you a woman. That is a very wrong perception that has been cultivated into the man in your heads, even when you are a child. That is very wrong. So mental health of a woman is very important. One should not be ashamed, and they should seek mental health whenever it's required. And I think I request all the husbands or anyone, a father or a brother, that you see someone who needs help, you promote them to get help. And last I'm going to tell is not a health problem. Actually, it is a request to all my colleagues, all my female friends out there, that every day you give 15 minutes to yourself for self-care. Now, what is that self-care? Self-care, it will not involve your children. Please, spending time with your children is not. It is your duty. And I love it. Self-care is for yourself. That's it. It also doesn't involve going with your friends and gossiping. It is a productive, positive thing you do. You meditate. You do simple stretching exercise. You wanted to paint in your life, but you couldn't. So you can start doing that. Let that painting take 1 month to complete because you are doing only 15 minutes per day. Let it be. But that 15 minutes you give for yourself. Why? Because you need to remember that you are just a human being. That is my request to all the women. I wish them all the best. They all are much stronger. I believe that I look to so many of them and I think, how can they be so strong? But I believe that being strong should not be a criteria to judge a woman. So let them make mistakes and let all of us appreciate them with all their mistakes. So thank you for giving me this opportunity of talking. And I wish all of them a happy Women's Day. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I guess that was the most important thing which is to be focused on this International Women's Day. And thank you very much for that 15-minute self-care activity which you advised all the women to do. Now I request Dr. Mrs. Shubhada Awsat, ma'am, to please come and share her thoughts on women empowerment with us all. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon to one and all. At the outset, I would like to wish all of you happy Women's Day. Now I am going to discuss about women empowerment. Before I start my discussion, I would like to mention two quotes. One is by Swami Vivekananda. He quoted that there is no chance for the welfare of the world unless the condition of women is improved. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru also said that when women move forward, the family moves, the villages move, and the nation moves. Now the question in all our mind is why there is a need of women empowerment. Have you heard any word like empowerment of men? Have you heard any word about empowerment of businessmen, empowerment of social, politicians. No. Why there is no need of empowerment of these? Because they are already the stronger and stronger sections. And empowerment in simply means strengthening the political, social, as well as economical strengths of any person or any individual. And that's why empowerment is directed towards the woman who is a, which section is a weaker section or disadvantaged section of the life. As women are the dynamic promoters of social transformation, their empowerment and education is must. If we see the status of women in modern India, definitely the status is good. Many women are at higher position, IAS, IPS, hence in science, technology, etc. If we see that the Mars mission, which was conducted by Indian Space Research Organization, many of the contributors of Mars mission were female. Even currently on 18th February, NASA conducted a project in which the Perseverance rover was landed over Mars. And it is our proud privilege to say that the leading was a female scientist, American scientist, Dr. Swati Mohan, who was an Indian origin. But if we see this empowerment or development, it is not throughout the same. It is not equal in all strata of the community, all strata of the society. In some strata of the society, still women are losing their lives. Still they are facing domestic violence. If we see the sex ratio in India in current decade, as per 2011 census, the sex ratio is declined than previous sex ratio. Even the Kerala, which was the state in which the sex ratio was favorable for females, it was the only state in India, but unfortunately the sex ratio declined in Kerala also. And all this, they give an essential need that there is a definite need of women empowerment. So what is empowerment? Empowerment refers to increasing the spiritual, political, social, or economic strength of individuals and communities. As a general definition, empowerment is a multidimensional process which helps the people to get control over their own lives. Now, what are the dimensions of women empowerment? There are mainly two dimensions: women's political and legal empowerment. As far as political empowerment is concerned, there are now reservations in assemblies for female candidates. Then another dimension is women economic and social empowerment. Now, six A's which are very, very necessary for women empowerment are: one is shiksha, that is education. Second is swastha, that is health. About that, Dr. Urmila has talked nicely. The third is Swavalamban, that is self-reliance. Fourth is Samajik Nay or social justice. Fifth is Samvedan or sensitivity. And sixth is Samata or equality. Now, principles of women empowerment: establish high-level corporate leadership about gender equality. Unfortunately, gender equality is not there in India. Lot of females are facing gender discrimination issues. So there is a corporate leadership needed for gender equality. Treat all men and women fairly at work. Give chances to everyone. Give opportunity for every worker despite of their sex. Ensure the health, safety and well-being of all women and men workers. Promote education. Education is the key of empowerment, and equality should be there. And this equality we can bring through community initiatives and through awareness generation programs. Now, approaches for women empowerment: one is through aware generation. There is necessity of behavior change communication so that women will not face any discrimination. For that, we can take help of self-help groups like Bachat Ghats, Anganwadis, government schemes are there, microfinance schemes are there. Again, I am repeating the sentence that education is the key of empowerment. So improve the educational standards at local level, state level, national level, as well as international level. In India, all girls get free education up to 14 years and of the age. And after that also, they get some scholarships. Now, there are some constraints or barriers in women empowerment. First is lack of education. Then there are traditional cultural barriers. Financial constraints are always there for females. Family responsibilities are there. Low mobility, low ability to bear the risk, and low social status. These are the barriers for women empowerment. There are certain government schemes for women empowerment. In India, there are 5 years plans which are implemented, and the 5 years plans of India aim at development of women with special emphasis on three core sectors, that is health, education and employment. So there is one national mission for empowerment of women. Under that mission, it was launched in April 2011. Under that mission, working women's hostel is provided. And under this scheme, all the working women, even single working women, women undergoing training for employment, they get safe and secure accommodation at reasonable and affordable price. Second is Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao Abhiyan. In 2011 census, the child sex ratio, that is sex ratio of 0 to 6 years, it declined to 914 per 1,000 males. And that's why this Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao Abhiyan was launched by our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji in 2015. And under this Abhiyan, all the strategies are there in order to prevent the female feticide, female infanticide, and to promote and improve the educational status of girl child. Second is STEP. STEP means Support to Training and Employment Program. The beneficiaries for this program are rural women and urban poor women. Support to Training and Employment aims at providing skills and competencies to the women, which will lead to their employability so that they can earn some livelihood. It provides in help in sectors including agriculture, horticulture, handicraft, computer, handloom, tailoring, etc. The skill training is given to rural women and urban poor women. Even some microfinancing is given in order to help them to get employability. Then next empowerment scheme is Mahila Shakti Kendra, which was launched in 2017. It aims to empower rural women with opportunities for skill development, employment, digital literacy, health, and nutrition. Women workforce, financial empowerment needs safe and secure job for the women. Even a 10% increase in women participating in workforce can boost the gross domestic product by 0.3%. But unfortunately, the women workforce in India is far below than the main workforce. And to provide safe working environment to female employees is responsibility of the organization. Workplace safety is a very, very important issue. As I have said, education and employment are the two essential needs for women empowerment. Indian Constitution has some legal provisions for female employees, like daily wages, working hours, maternity leaves, etc. But again, providing safe and secure working environment is the responsibility of organization. And for this matter, every organization should have Women's Complaint Committee. How this Women Complaint Committee works, what are roles and responsibilities, about that, the overview will be taken by my colleague, Dr. Mrs. Anita Rao. Thank you, Social Cell, for giving me an opportunity to talk about women empowerment. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. To continue with the next part of this session, our topic is Women's Complaint Committee and Overview. So before going to this topic, I would like to speak a few words on women. In Yajurveda, it is said that Sa Vishvayu, Sa Vishvakarma, Sa Vishvadhyaya Indrasaya, Tvam Bhagam Somena, Atna Chamin, Vishnu Havam Raksha. So meaning of this in English, that is, she is the life of all universe. She is the creator. She is the one who holds as a mother. She is the part of the one who has controlled senses. The one who is full of life. The one who could brought her properly. And she is the solutions, the medication. So you all must protect her. That is Havam Raksha. So we salute to the divine feminine power that controls the universe and allow to be its descendants in the world as a force of creation. Thus, we celebrate the most important aspect of our life in terms of International Women's Day. So, on this occasion, I would like to have few words on Women Complaint Committee of our institute. The Women's Complaint Committee is institutionalized to hear complaints and grievances in relation to incidents of harassment. Along with that, it is constituted to inquire into the grievance and make recommendations toward the complaints brought in front of it. So, looking towards, we have vision and mission of Women's Complaint Committee, its scope, various roles and responsibilities, operational definitions are some there, as well as the complaint procedure will see. So vision and mission, as per the Constitution of India, right to equality is a fundamental right that includes the right to equality before law, prohibition of gender discrimination and equality of opportunities for men as well as women in matter of public employment. So Article 21 of Constitution of India mentions right to live with dignity, and our medical college and hospital is bound to provide this right to all women. So the mission is to provide safe and healthy work environment to women and provide guidelines to work with dignity and handle related complaints received or referred to the committee. So in our institution is bound to the same directives. In compliance with the mandate of the Supreme Court judgment, our college adopts the policy to prevent, prohibit, and punish any type of harassment of women at the workplace. So the college is committed to provide all women who fall with its jurisdiction, including its academic, non-academic staff and students, a place for work and study, which is free from harassment, intimidation, and exploitation. So there are some definitions which comes under this committee. These are operational definitions. So what do you mean by workplace? The workplace includes any place where the employee of the organization carry out tasks to further the organizational goals and objectives. So this will not include any place of work that is beyond institute premise and its control. So now it must be, the complaint must be from employee or from the staff. An employee of institute is an individual who has been appointed at the organization to carry out certain tasks. So it covers all the staff on the payroll, including the teaching staff, non-teaching staff, contractual, paramedical, nursing, as well as supportive services staff, etc. So the students are also there. Students will include any candidate enrolled in the institute as a trainee in capacity of undergraduate, postgraduate, as well as nursing, paramedical, undergoing training in our college, medical college, and the hospital. So there are various responsibilities, the rules of the committee. So the first one, to develop the policy and guideline for the complaint procedure, as well to disseminate the guidelines among the employees, to take necessary steps to resolve the complaints, as well as to give recommendations to the authorities for grievance redressals, and to organize and conduct regular meetings, to give the feedback also to the appropriate authorities. Another procedure is that the complaint procedures to continue written, and it should be signed complaint of a woman regarding issue at workplace. It has to be submitted to the chairman, preferably within 15 days of occurrence of incidents. The complaint will be called by the committee for personal meeting with two members of the committee within 7 days from the submission of the complaint. Next part, the chairman and the secretary call committee meeting with a week from the submission of the complaints. The members of the committee will discuss the various points of the complaints, and the inquiry committee will be set up, which includes presiding officer, preferably senior woman employee of the institute, and the members. The inquiry committee should arrange personal meeting with the complainant. As well, the strict confidentiality should be mentioned for the entire procedures. So the inquiry committee will submit the report within necessary recommendations to the Women's Complaint Committee within 15 days. So the chairman and the secretary of the committee will discuss the report with appropriate authority for the further actions. So the entire procedure of the committee should be completed within 30 days of submission of the complaint, and the feedback is given immediately to the complainant. So our institute has constituted the Women's Complaint Committee, and the members are here. The chairman is Dr. Mrs. Outset Madam, Professor and Head Department of Community Medicine. The secretary, myself, Anita Rao, Assistant Professor from Department of Biochemistry. And the committee also has the members, the Dr. Mrs. R. R. Naik Madam from the Ophthalmology Department, Dr. Mrs. Sharyu Valerao from the Obstetrics Department, as well as Dr. Sneha Murade, Associate Professor from the Ophthalmology Department, as well as Dr. Mrs. Sonali Bhagat from the Department of Biochemistry. So the mobile numbers are also given here. In case of any complaint, anytime you can come to the Women's Complaint Committee and you can lodge the complaints whenever you want to put up there. So to conclude with this, I again wish all of you, my dear and near women's, happy International Day. Thank you.
Thank you, Raup Madam. That was a very nice lecture. All the three lectures were very nice. Thank you, Dr. Mrs. Shubhada Outset Madam. Thank you, Dr. Mrs. Gauri Madam. And thank you, Dr. Mrs. Raup Madam, for all these nice lectures. I personally thank from the social cell of Vithal Rao Vikhe Patil Foundation's Medical College and Women's Complaint Committee, I thank our respected Secretary General, retired Lieutenant General Dr. B. Sadananda sir. I thank our Deputy Director, Dr. Abhijit Dute sir. I thank our respected Dean, Dr. Sunil Nata Maske sir, for giving us this opportunity. And I conclude that today's webinar is over. Thank you very much, and happy, wish you all a very happy International Women's Day. Thank you.